growing in deadwood like this, whether it's a fallen log is something that happens very frequently in nature. In human-dominated forests, we also have stumps, so you also see this happening in the stumps. It's kind of a strange characteristic, and not all plants do it. So, for example, we don't find Douglas fir doing it, and of the other shrubs, salal and red huckleberry seem to be the main ones we see doing it. We don't often see salmonberry, for example, doing it. So it's kind of funny that some plants have evolved to be able to do that. I'd like you to think about why. So first, I'd like you to pause the video and take about 2 minutes to see if you can think of all of the positive reasons, all of the advantages of growing in deadwood. And then I'd like you to also think about all of the disadvantages of growing in deadwood. So pause the video, take 2 minutes and come up with that list, and then hit play again. I'm going to jump in right away with one that students always give as an advantage, and it's always wrong, but it's a good guess. And that is, students usually say that growing in dead wood is going to be a good source of nutrients, that the dead wood is nutrient rich. And that's actually the opposite. The dead wood is quite nutrient poor. And I know why you think that, because we often talk about organic matter as being very nutrient rich, and that's true, and wood is a kind of organic matter. But if you think about the tree and where the different nutrients are in the tree, the wood is mostly carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, maybe a few other trace elements. The really important nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, other things, those are mostly in the foliage and the fine twigs, especially in the photosynthetically active tissues. So there's nitrogen in the fallen leaves and fallen needles, but not much in the wood. So it's actually a disadvantage to grow in the wood. So one advantage that hopefully many of you came up with is in relation to light. So you can imagine this log is maybe 50 centimeters, 60 centimeters above the forest floor. And that doesn't seem like a lot, but you can imagine if you're a tiny seedling, 1 or 2 centimeters tall, growing here rather than growing here might dramatically improve your light conditions. So that might give you an edge. So that's a pretty obvious advantage. Other potential advantages, there might not be as much competition with other plants because relatively few species grow in the rotting wood. So that's a possibility. Another advantage that may not be obvious to you, but also relates to being a tiny little seedling. So remember, tiny little seedlings are really vulnerable to drought stress. A drought that isn't really an issue for a giant Douglas fir that's a meter in diameter, is potentially going to kill a tiny little seedling. So water availability is really important. And maybe I've explained this to you in another video so far, maybe you haven't come across it yet, but these forests here have a pronounced water deficit in the summer. In the lower mainland, there's relatively little precipitation during the summer, and that can put a lot of drought stress on trees, and especially seedlings, so it can dramatically reduce their likelihood of survival. This rotting wood, on the other hand, if I feel it, it did rain a couple days ago, and this rotting wood is really wet. If you've ever felt a rotting log, it's often kind of spongy, and it absorbs water really well. So you can imagine that a seedling that's growing in this log in a drought might fare better than a seedling that's growing in this soil, because it'll have just enough water to get it through that drought. So the main advantages are better light availability, some moisture-holding capacity of that rotting wood for a drought, and perhaps a little bit of a reduction in competition from other plant species. Disadvantages, we already said that that rotting wood is pretty nutrient-poor. So some of these plants, like the red huckleberry and the salal, are in the Ericaceae family, and they have associations with ericoid mycorrhiza, fungal organisms that can help supply them with nutrients, so that might help them a little bit in these cases. And otherwise, you'll notice that these trees, and hemlock is pretty good at growing in nutrient-poor conditions, and you'll also see there's a lot of roots pretty quickly trying to get down into the soil. So those trees are going to try to get roots down into the soil as quickly as possible to counteract that deficit. The other really big disadvantage that you've probably figured out is structural. So if it's a small log and the tree and it rots slowly and the tree is able to grow big and grow big roots, then that tree is probably going to be in pretty good shape by the time that log rots away. However, especially for some of these giant stumps that we have with the tree growing on top of it, that tree is never going to be able to have a strong enough root structure to be able to support itself when that stump rots away. So these trees are going to be a little bit less structurally sound in the long run, and they're kind of in a race against time between their root growth and the rotting of that log to get stable enough before that that log erodes away or rots away. And you will periodically come across in the forest a tree that normally wouldn't have buttressed roots. You'll see a lot of roots on a big mature tree. You'll see a lot of roots kind of sticking out well above the ground. And the tree is stable, but that structure tells you that that tree started growing in a rotting log. And after that log rotted away, the tree did have enough root structure to continue to support itself.